never walked a mile in your shoes, tasted the tears you've cried. I've never known the deepest longings you hold inside. I've had my share of disenchantments, days when I've been so low, and I'm here to say no.
I will be there. is far above rubies, but she's content with little things. She never wants to be seen, but it's obvious that she's a queen. And even though she's not aware, she's touched your life, the proof is there. And every seed she plants will grow, and when you see her, you will know. She's right before your eyes, a diamond in disguise. Heaven sent a virtuous woman. She's an angel and she's in your life. And I bet you didn't know, she's an angel and she's in your life. Heart has felt your pain, her fervent prayers have kept you sane, and whether near or far, she's played a part in who you are. And even though she's not aware, she's touched your life, the proof is there. And every seed she plants will grow, and when you see her, you woman, I tell you what, she's right before your eyes, a diamond in disguise. Heaven sent a virtuous woman. She's an angel, and she's right in your heart.
Angel in disguise.
Welcome to Soul Cafe Radio, where we cater food for the mind and soul. Please join us this hour for uplifting music, messages, and more. And now to the RMG Studios in Miami Gardens, Florida, and your host, the Word Master.
Hello friends, and welcome to Soul Cafe Radio for Friday, October 8, 2021. Today, as we continue to look at our week of amazing women of the Bible, we conclude this week by looking at Mary Magdalene, one of the most inspirational women of Scripture. Her story is a tough one, but it still needs to be told, because in her experience, she does give the same theme that we're looking at all week, a lesson of love, loyalty, and leadership. Listen to her story as we continue today here on a very special Soul Cafe Radio, Amazing Women of the Bible. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your loving kindness and your tender mercies towards us. Thank you for allowing us the opportunity to be here today. Oh Lord God, we love you, we praise you, and we give you all the honor and glory that you so richly deserve. Thank you for the listeners. Thank you for everyone who chooses to be on today. I pray that your words will come through with clarity and that everyone who hears will be tremendously blessed. Thank you for speaking to our hearts, O God, and I pray that as we go forward in today's experiences, the lessons that are gleaned will stay with us, not just the years of time, but throughout eternity, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. So once again, I want to thank you for joining us today on Soul Cafe Radio, looking at these amazing women of the Bible. We'll be back right after this short break. We'll come back from our song break with our scripture reading for the morning, and then shortly after that, we'll get into the lesson. We'll forego our morning's reading from Sons and Daughters of God, but on your own, you can read it. October 8th reading from Sons and Daughters of God, the devotional reading for the day. And by the way, on the website, soulcafeonline.org, on the radio page, right below the radio player, is a link to the amazing book, Daughters of God, and I encourage you to download it. It's in PDF format. So there's that, and please pay attention to the description area so that the information that we talked about the other day about the Women Empowerment Conference, that you may be abreast of it, which is coming up very shortly. So as we take our break and go to our songs, pay attention to the description area, and if you're on soulcafeonline.org, please download that book, Daughters of God. Stay tuned.
You're listening to Soul Cafe Radio, food for the mind and soul.
Please take a few seconds to support the channel. See the info in the description.
Christ in love breathe.
If you're just joining us, you're listening to Soul Cafe Radio, as we just heard, Food for the Mind and Soul. I want to take you back to our scripture reading found in John chapter 12, and we'll begin. First of all, let me address this most important thought. Well, I'll get into it when we get into the study proper, but our scripture reading is taken from John chapter 12, verses 1 to 7. Then Jesus, 6 days before the Passover, came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, which had been dead, whom he raised from the dead. They made him a supper, and Martha served, but Lazarus was one of them that sat at the table with him. Then took Mary a pound of ointment of spikenard, very costly, and anointed the feet of Jesus, and wiped his feet with her hair, and the house was filled with the odor of the ointment. Then said one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, which should betray him, Why was not this ointment sold for 300 pence and given to the poor? This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief and had a bag and bare what was therein. Then said Jesus, Let her alone. Against the day of my burying had she kept this. At this time, we'll pause again and go to our theme song before we begin our lesson for today. Amazing Women of the Bible. Today's study, Mary Magdalene.
Whisper, there's no place here for her kind. Still on she came, through the shame that flushed her face, until at last she knelt before his feet. And though she spoke no words, everything she said was heard. As she poured her love for the master from her box of alabaster, and I've come to pour my praise on him like oil from Mary's alabaster vase. Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and I dry them with my hair. You weren't there the night he found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his love all around me. And you don't know of the oil in my alabaster pot. I can't forget the way life used to be. I was a prisoner to the sin that had me bound. Poured my life without measure into a little treasure box I thought I found. Jesus came to me and healed my soul with the wonder of His touch. So now I'm giving back to Him all the praise He's worthy of. I've been forgiven, and that's why I love Him so much. And I've come to pour my praise on Him like all. Don't be angry if I wash His feet with my tears and dry them with my hair. My hair, you are there. The night Jesus found me, you did not feel what I felt when He wrapped His loving arms around me.
In Luke chapter 7, verses 36 unto 50, we read these words. And one of the Pharisees, desired him that he would eat with him. And he went into the Pharisee's house and sat down to meat. And behold, a woman in the city, which was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at meat in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster box of ointment, and stood at his feet behind him weeping, and began to wash his feet with tears, and did wipe them with the hairs of her head, and kissed his feet, and anointed them with the ointment. Now when the Pharisee which had bidden him saw it, he spake within himself, saying, This man, if he were a prophet, would have known who and what manner of woman this is that touched him, for she is a sinner. And Jesus answering said unto him, Simon, I have somewhat to say unto you. And he said, Master, say on. There was a certain creditor which had two debtors. The one owed 500 pence, and the other 50. And when they had nothing to pay, he frankly forgave them both. Tell me therefore, which of them would love him most? Simon answered and said, I suppose that he to whom he forgave most. And he said unto him, Thou hast rightly judged. Simon answered and said, verse 44, excuse me, And he turned to the woman and said unto Simon, Seest thou this woman? I entered unto thine house. Thou gavest me no water for my feet, but she had washed my feet with her tears, and wiped them with the hairs of her head. Thou gavest me no kiss, but this woman, since the time I came in, had not ceased to kiss my feet. My head with oil thou didst not anoint, but this woman hath anointed my feet with ointment. Wherefore I say unto thee, her sins which are many are forgiven, for she loved much, but to whom little is forgiven, the same loveth little. And he said unto her, Thy sins be forgiven. And they that sat at meat with him began to say within themselves, Who is this that forgiveth sins also? And he said unto the woman, Thy faith hath saved thee. Go in peace. A very interesting account we are given of this woman. We first are introduced to her in the book of John chapter 8, and her is to whom we ascribe as the woman caught in adultery. We next meet her right here. Well, prior to that, in John, we see that she is she's the sister of Lazarus and Martha, Lazarus being the one who was raised from the dead there in John 11. And we see her again later on, right before the crucifixion. The Bible tells us 6 days before the Passover. And then finally, we're introduced to her at the gravesite, where she becomes the first one to see him alive. And notice what the Bible says of her in Mark chapter 16 and verse 9. The Bible says, Now when Jesus was risen early on the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast seven devils. Yes, friends, the Mary that they call Magdalene is the Mary of our study today, who is the woman caught in adultery, who is Lazarus and Martha's sister. And by now, you can tell the completeness of the narrative. If you just follow the threads, you will see her story, who she was, and what type of person she was. Let's just unpack a few things. Judas was distressed that all that was wasted on her. Simon was disgusted that Jesus allowed her to touch him. The Bible tells us that Judas was this very Simon's son. But did you know that this Simon was also her uncle? Yes, friends. And interestingly enough, he would have known exactly the narrative of John chapter 8. And that's why he would have been able to tell Jesus, do you know what type of person she is? Basically, just to take it out of the area of mysticism, she was a prostitute. That was her career. And the wages that the Bible talks about, that's how she earned her living back in the day, friends. That's how she earned her living back in the day. But Jesus, the Bible said, had cast seven devils out of her. And you might want to say and try to picture seven devils being cast out of one person. What an evil person she was, right? But I want to believe, and I'm strongly believing, that this was not all at once. This was on seven different occasions, that just like then, she came to Jesus in tears, feeble, that weaker vessel that Peter talks about, humbled because she knows that Jesus is a friend of sinners. And from that initial experience, how she was. You see, friends, Mary's story is a story that's rife with shame, rife with reproach, rife with contempt. But the thing about it is, in the end, none of that faced her. Because there when she visited with Jesus, when he came to her house, there with Mary Martha and Lazarus at dinner, and probably others were there as well as it was at dinner. Jesus was teaching in, I guess it was the living room, the parlor room, where all the guests were assembled. And who was there sitting at his feet but Mary? And this incensed her sister so much that she had to come to Jesus and say to tell Jesus to tell her to get into the kitchen and serve, because that was her role, that was her duty. But Jesus said to Martha, Martha, Mary has chosen the better part. You see, friends, while Martha was anxious about the things that are external, the things that are temporal, Mary was looking into those things that are eternal. And having that close proximity to him, she would have heard the gospel story in clarity. She would have understood when he mentioned about his death. And not having any preconceived notions of grandeur blocking the way, she wouldn't have allowed things like her being glorified on some throne as a ruler among the 12 to bother her from fully understanding what he was saying. And so, in those intervening months, she had a plan. And this alabaster box that she bought, in and of itself, was an object lesson, a lesson of the Savior himself, who, when he was broken, his fragrance filled not just the room, but the whole world. Mary, Jesus himself said, her story, the gospel, let me just let you hear it, how Jesus puts it. Friends, I tell you, when we begin to study these things that it seems like an insignificant piece of something that was read, we gloss it over, it takes on a life of its own that is so important. Matthew 26 and verse 13, Jesus says, verily I say unto you, wheresoever this gospel shall be preached in the whole world, there shall also this that this woman had done be told for a memorial of her. So in Matthew 26, Jesus says that this gospel, as it's preached, this story will be part of the experience. And sure enough, literally in the four gospels, it is mentioned. And as you just heard in the song, alabaster box, Mary's alabaster box, it is memorialized. How many of us do not know this song? It's a very well-known song. But friends, to get into the heart and mind of Mary, this, as I mentioned, friends, as I mentioned, these women and their experiences teach us about love, loyalty, and leadership. We know that our first Mary, the mother of Jesus, and her family weren't all that well off. We see that she had to give a turtle dove as an offering instead of a lamb at Jesus' dedication, so we knew of the poverty. But this Mary, we know these were well-off people. How do we know? Because there's not too many people that are mentioned whose burial places are in the sides of mountains, or in other words, who get buried in caves, as it were. So we know that her family was well off. In fact, we see the connection with the Pharisees. So we know that Mary didn't have to do what Mary did. We know that her life didn't have to be that way that it was. But again, as we saw with Rebecca on yesterday, and in her latter days when she plotted with Jacob to get what was rightfully his, but she did not wait on the Lord. We see that Mary, in her own way, was trying to feel some type of way that only Jesus could satisfy. She could relate to the woman that we only know as the woman at the well. She could relate. But you see, friends, there was something in Mary that said, I don't like this type of life. And ultimately, Mary had had enough. And this last act that we kept reading about in the Gospels, the story of how she anointed his feet and wiped his feet with her hair, washed them with her tears. This story tells us that this was her final straw. She had enough. And in the end, Jesus would have said, he said unto the woman, thy faith hath saved thee. Go in peace. Beloved, understand this, that as you listen to Mary's experience, as you understand the flawedness of this woman, this was not Mary who angels came to and promised the Messiah. This was not Queen Esther who was the deliverer of her people. This was not Rebecca who would be the mother that would be literally the mother of the millions that were promised. This was Mary Magdalene, the prostitute. This was Mary Magdalene, the woman caught in adultery. This was Mary Magdalene, the woman who the Bible says Jesus cast 7 devils out of her. We're told that he cast out a legion of devils at one point. We are told that he cast out a very nasty set of devils out of a little boy. But it is the experience of this woman that he had cast out these devils from that we are told will be memorialized. Where is the song about the legions being cast out? Where is the song about the boy that was cast into the fire? You have ever memorialized Mary's alabaster box. You have a little book entitled The Gospel According to Mary. Very beautiful book. Very touching story. If you could ever get your hand on it, it'll be a very good read. Beloved, this day as we look at Mary, there's one lesson that I want us to take away from this. That this was a very flawed individual. Even though she came from a well-to-do family, even though her story tells of people who were well-off enough to host dinner parties, well-off enough to be buried in caves instead of a hole in the ground, well-off enough, but yet flawed nonetheless, because at the end of the day, religion is a thing that money can't buy. A relationship with Jesus Christ is something that not all the gold in all the world could afford us. And ultimately, the peace that he offered her in Luke 7 and verse 15 cannot be purchased no matter how much we throw at Jesus' feet. It has to be given. And he says, my peace I give unto you. And this young lady, as she sought for this peace, could not find it. And man after man after man after man could not satisfy, just like the woman at the well. And I could imagine her singing that song like the woman at the well. I was seeking for the things that could not satisfy. And then I heard my Savior speaking, drink of my well that never shall run dry. You see, beloved, in looking at Mary Magdalene, we're looking at all of us. We're looking at flawed lives. Not many of us, it's only the elect select few, the select few that are favored enough to be called the super wealthy, the well off. They go to sleep, wake up unworried about what's in a bank and what's in the refrigerator. They don't have to worry about this, that, and the other. Not many of us are in that situation, friends. But all of us are in a situation where we are at the end of the day, flawed human beings, but for the grace of God, here go I. But for the grace of God, here go I. Mary, did you know that one day that this whole world will know your story? That one day your whole life will be exposed for the world to know. And some, not knowing the end of the story, would say, what a wretched woman she was. Several devils have to be cast out of her. What a wretch she was. But oh, amazing grace, how sweet a sound, the songwriter says, that saved a wretch like me. And that includes our sister Mary. You see, friends, as disgraced as she was, as humiliated as she was at Simon's feast, oh, friend of mine, her story did not end there. And thanks be to God, it did not end there. Because you see, friends, on early that Sunday morning, when she went back to the grave, after being one of the last there on Friday evening as it began to dawn towards Sabbath, she made sure that she was the first one there. She made sure that she was at the tomb. Why? Why, you ask? Why was she at the tomb? She figured that she finished the job. She figured that the thing that she did not get to do in making sure that his body is properly preserved, she'll do it very early before the rest of the women got there. But oh, glorious, glorious news. She met an empty tomb. But in her despair, in her sadness, she forgot one very important piece of the gospel story. I'll rise again. And in her tears and in her despair, she heard in her familiar language, Miriam, Miriam, who do you seek? And in her tears, as she recognized that glorious voice, not the gardener, but her Redeemer, she clutches after him, my Rabboni, my teacher. And Mary became privileged to be the herald of the gospel, first herald at that, and a woman to pronounce and to proclaim the glory of the gospel. We have this hope story. He is risen. I have seen the Messiah. I tell you, he's alive. Beloved, from disgrace to receiving his grace, friends, it doesn't get any better than that. And sweet, sweet Mary Magdalene, her story lives on for all the other Mary Magdalenes in the world that's there that are saying, in the words of our upcoming song, is there a heaven for me? We pause and I'll let you listen. And as you listen, beloved, I want you to contemplate the fact that there is a heaven for you. That no matter what you've been through, no matter what you've done, that yes, there is a heaven for you. Listen, meditate upon this song. And if you have not done so, I invite you to invite Jesus into your heart.
Listening to Soul Cafe Radio, food for the mind and soul.
Please take a few seconds to support the channel. See the info in the description.
Indeed, modern day Mary Magdalenes, there is a heaven for you. There is a heaven for each and every one of us. who truly believe. And could you, in your mind's eye, watch with me as Mary sits at the feet of Jesus and listens to him telling all these amazing things and wondering for herself, is there a heaven for me? Is there such a place for such a wretch as I? And to know how privileged that she would have been to be the first human being to gaze upon the eyes of the Savior of the world in his risen form. What an assurance. And to you, dear modern day Marys, and to you, amazing women of today, he says the same thing. There is a heaven for you. In the midst of your love and loyalty and leadership, God has promised you that there is a rich reward. Yes, you Proverbs 31 women, God has a heaven for you. And at the end of all your labors, at the end of all your trials, at the end of all your toils in this world, when it seems like no one appreciates, no one truly understands, no one gets you, there is a heaven for you, a place where all of your labors and toils, all of the tears and trials, a place where it would have been worth it all. I pray that you will have such a heart, such a hope to continue to endure, to know, beloved sisters in the Lord, that your labor is not in vain. And this goes for each and every one of you, dear listeners. May God bless you abundantly as you continue to be amazing. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the time that you granted unto us today. We pray that your Holy Spirit will continue to prick our hearts as we continue to learn the lessons that you've been seeking to teach us this week, and especially today, that when it all seems hopeless, that you, who never make a mistake, you, who never, ever is wrong, you have set your love upon this young lady, and we are told that only by love is love awakened, and oh, was her love awakened, and how richly she was repaid for her faithfulness here, and am assured that in the hereafter, so much more. Thank you, Jesus, for being with us during the study. We praise you, God, for the lessons that we've learned, not just today, but all throughout this week. We love you and praise you, and we give you all the grace, glory, and honor that you so richly deserve, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for being with us today, friends. Thank you for joining us on this week as we look at amazing women of the Bible. We'll continue next week, and some of the women highlighted will be Rachel, that we did not look at this week, Deborah, Dorcas, Lydia, among others. And if you have other women that you'd like to see highlighted, please put it in the comment section, whether on WhatsApp, Facebook, Twitter, and we'll look at them as we go throughout this month, looking at amazing women of the Bible. Now, as we promised, if you have a business that has struggled, or if you yourself personally have been affected this past year, and you've lost your job, and you're struggling with loss of income, and you just want to promote your business or your services, and things are too expensive, I'm offering for this month the opportunity to submit a 30-second to a minute-long audio describing your business, giving us information how we can reach you, and it'll be posted here on Soul Cafe Radio for the remainder of the month. And that being said, we close out with one of those presentations from Panyaya LLC.
Do you think the call center industry is right for you? My name is Hyacinth, and I'd like to introduce to you an existing opportunity in our work from home company, Panyaya LLC. So we are looking for new and existing customer service professionals to join our company. This is a great opportunity for those who are unable to work away from home, need to work flexible hours, or just need an additional source of income. You can be your own boss. Panyaya LLC will provide you with the necessary resources to help you as you work from home, and we will be with you every step of the way. We can be reached at 954-302-2580 or visit our website at www.penyayallc.com. That's www.penyayallc.com, or send us an email at info@penyayallc.com.
Thank you for joining us today on Soul Cafe Radio. You've been listening to powerful music and messages for the mind and soul. Join us next time when we deliver more of the same, and remember to visit our website at www.soulcafeonline.org.